Somebody had asked how to make a tube sock on the flatbed or the knitter only. It is fairly easy. There's really not much to it. You do need to measure your stitches and rows per inch to figure out your pattern. You also need to measure from the base of your toe, which would be right here, under your foot and up your leg to where you want the top of the sock to be. When you measure around your foot, you do have to subtract 10% of that. It will stretch out on you. But anyways, with the tube sock, see, I could wear it like this. I could wear it this way. I'm going to get more use out of a tube sock because I'm not going to have the wear on the heel as much as with a fitted sock that has the heel on it. So in my case, I ended up with 4.5 stitches and 6 rows to the inch. Around my measured around the ball of my foot is 9.5. Subtract 10% comes down to 8.5. And what I did was I just took my calculator, took 9.5, subtract 10, and then the percentage sign, and that's how I come up with the 8.5. And then from the base of my toe up, I got 14.5 inches. That times the 6 rows comes out to 87 rows. Now, I did do a folded picot hem here, so I'm going to do the same on the other one. These are going to be more or less slipper socks for myself, being that it's acrylic. For regular socks, I like to use natural fibers. Mostly wool is what I've done, but cotton's another good one. So what I do with the, when I'm doing the picot hem, is I like to have either one end or both ends with 2 needles on it. Because I started out with 39 stitches, I now have 2 stitches on both ends and then every other needle. Now, I want 2-inch hem, so 6 times 2 is 12. I need to double that up. But in the middle, I need to bring the empty needles out to hold. And with the bond machine, I have the needles all the way out to holding position. I will then take those and bring them back. Now, as mentioned before, I bring these needles back until the latch starts to move, but they're still open. I make sure all the latches are open. If not, I open them. So now I need to knit 11 more rows. And because I need my counter, I had to get my ISM carriage. Feels like I gotta spray my key plate again. Now I bring the needles out to holding position. I remove my cast-on comb and weights. I will need them again. And then I just take I could use my 3-prong tool, and I could take the first loop and then the next loop and get those on the first and second needle, although I probably should have gone second and fourth. Then I take the next 2 loops, I skip a needle. So I do that all the way down. So I am creating my folded hem, or the picot hem in this case. After that, I will hang my cast-on comb again. Now, for those of you that use the black hem, It is a little bit awkward to do it, but start out with waist yarn and a row of ravel cord. Push the work behind the open latches, e-wrap cast on, and start knitting from there. So you have that little bit extra at the end, in the beginning. For the weight on the machine. Because I'm so used to using a cast-on comb, and I do have this from another machine that's 8mm, I'm going to be using this one. I believe I may have mentioned that already. Okay, so now I need to put my counter back to 12. Because I only want to count the half of those stitches. Now I'm going to knit to row 87. First of all, with this machine, I do have to push these needles back to forward working position. I have to make sure that the latches are open. And just start knitting until I get to row 87. And I dropped a stitch there, so I better fix it before I go on. I could see it behind there, so I could go ahead and just hang it on the needle. But I need to take the right loop here and get it in the hook, lift the next loop up. Now I didn't get that one on there, but that's all right. You know, this is going to be on the inside anyways. Sure if I mentioned this before, but I do have this silicone spray that is made for Bond America, also called the Easy Knit Spray. I had bought a silicone spray from the hardware store, and I didn't look at it very good at the store, but when I got it home, I had read the back side of this, and there was propane as the propellant. Well, I didn't want to spray propane on my key plates or on the bed. And what I do is I just spray going across the key plate, and every once in a while I'll go across the needle bed back here, and let me show you what that did. Now I'm knitting smoothly. All you have to do is short row half of the stitches down to thirds, and then reverse short row, work off on waist yarn, graft the last row to itself, and then sew the side seam. Now, because I started out with 39 stitches, I have 19 stitches over here and 20 stitches over here. Oh well, I'm one stitch off, no big deal. When I graft, I'll take the two end needles stitches on the side here and make it as one stitch so it matches up with the 19 over here. I could have increased one stitch at the end of the ribbon or the hem to make it even, but you don't really have to. Okay, so now 20 stitches. That's not divisible by 3. 21 is divisible by 3, which is 7. Well, so what's going to happen is I'm going to have 6 stitches, 7 stitches, 6 stitches. The two outside ones are going to be brought out to hold to do the short rows. You're going to have 7 needles in the middle. That's if you get the same gauge as I have and your foot's the same measurement as mine, in working position. On the Bond machines, I do have to move my claw weights up every two rows, sometimes every row. I just keep an eye on the stitches there. If they start popping up on that hook, I pull the material down. And not so much the center claw weight, but the two outside ones, as I'm working, will be moved up. So I bring the needle closest to the carriage, out to hold. I'm going to knit across. And sometimes that happens. And I even drop the stitch. So I will undo that. I will bring the carriage back over to the left again. I did have to go back to my blue carriage. Now, luckily, I could grab this one stitch. It didn't unravel itself. Well, maybe I can't. So I go to the stitch below. I get it on the needle. I pull that last stitch up so it unravels. And then I will just lift up that loop, push it into the hook, and hand knit that back. Okay, so some of these had gone behind the open latches. I need to my zero was missing. Okay. I also have to open these latches. Now let me try that again. I know that I'm not holding the carriage correctly over here. I should be holding it in the center. And at times I forget. So it's best to go slow so that you don't do that. Sometimes I notice the end needle doesn't want to grab the yarn as it's working it up. Probably not the greatest claw weight I had there. So what I do is, as I'm going along, I could go slow and I could see if it's actually grabbing it. If it doesn't, I take my one prong tool and I push it down, making sure that hook grabs that yarn. Every two rows, I move my claw weights up, the outside ones. And again. That's why this machine is very temperamental, and you do have to be a little bit more cautious with this machine than you do with other machines. So I'm going to finish doing the short rows. When I get to the reverse short rows, I'll get back to recording again and show you how I do that. Now to do the reverse short rows, first of all I take my yarn, wrap it underneath the first hook that's on the side of the carriage, and because I like to do the automatic wrap, I will pull two needles opposite the carriage. You would, for the manual wrap, you would just put one back there. When you get the carriage over, you would wrap the yarn under that next needle. But the automatic wrap, if you bring two needles to the forward working position, knit across, take the last stitch knitted, bring that out to hold, it will wrap itself, one last step that you have to deal with. And it kind of skipped there again, but I could manually knit those last two stitches. Now, opposite the carriage, I put two needles into the forward working position, knit back. put the last stitch knitted into hold. So I'm going to do this until I'm down to almost the last row, and then I need to get, well, I like getting the yarn in the center here so I could graft that last row and then sew the side of the sock. This is where I would normally bring the last needle over here back to hold so it wraps, but I only have one needle here on the right to bring back into work. I want to finish off in the center like I mentioned before, and then I'm going to work up waste yarn on the left side here, put those stitches, take it off the machine, put those stitches on these hooks, and graft. You will see the grafting in my next video. Actually, to cut the yarn, what I do is I go two lengths of what's going to be grafted, then I take that spot, and I go down to where it's going to sew, and then I just grab some more yarn to make sure I have enough. Now I'm going to work these up on waste yarn and move it over to this side.